Hey folks, Sylvius here. Alright, I'm on my new unvocation character, Franklin Roosevelt. Supposed to be Franklin Roosevelt, but they wouldn't let me, that name is apparently an illegal combination, so I just spaced between the Rose and the Velt. So he's basically still Franklin Roosevelt. If I put the D in there, they wouldn't let me put a single letter, and that also made his name too long. So he's Franklin Roosevelt. Anyway. Franklin here, I'm just going to refer to him as FDR, by the way. FDR here is my new, he's going to be a sorcerer. I'm on Silvera. He's going to be the character that only plays in free areas. Because I think that's interesting. And that's really all the reason I need. Anyway, he's going to be the character that only plays in free areas. Furthermore, he's going to be the character that I use to talk politics. I am a pretty opinionated person. And I enjoy talking politics and talking about those kind of things. But, you know, I understood that that was probably pushing it for certain people on my, like, regular videos. So I decided to ultimately make a character all about talking to politics. So that's what FDR here is going to do. By the way, FDR is named after Franklin Delano Roosevelt, one of the presidents of the United States during the Great Depression. Really good president in my mind. Anyway. Just to, again, go over that. Franklin, FDR here, will always be playing on in free areas. He will quest in premium areas. He will access the boat. He will get a promotion. He will go to premium areas if he needs supplies that are premium only. I really wish that. Actually, can I control W to get... Well, too late. I think you can hit control W to get rid of that test. That text. He will go to premium areas. He just won't always be in premium areas. Now, I don't want to copy that one. I want to copy Rudis. There we go. Copy. Rename. There we go. Now, what are my spells here? I want to set up my spells real quick. Buzz. Exori Infraviz. Control K. Exori Infraviz. You know, it'd be kind of cool if they, when they started these new characters, they just started them with a hotkey preset. That'd be kind of awesome. Alright. Exavo Infer Flame Flam Her. Alright. Exavo Infer Flam Her. And last but not least, Exura Infer on F1. Infer. And do I have... Potions are good. Mostly. Alright, good enough. I'll just manually use the other things. Alright. So anyway, that's the deal with... Ooh, I'm a little laggy. That's awesome. Not really. That's the deal with this character's, like, concept. So he'll be, you know, like I said, mostly on the free areas. I'll hunt things in, like, Mintwall, the Orc Fort, the Troll Fort, or the Troll Cave by face, Ghostlands, whatever. And, you know, I'm just doing that because I think it's interesting. Yay, leveled up. Yay, that attack is, like, pointless. I mean, it's cool that it hits multiple enemies, but god, it does no damage. On the talking about politics topic, each video will kind of be, like, devoted to a specific topic. When I finish kind of giving my explanation of how things are, my topic will be the Democratic debate that happened last night. About, like, 10 hours ago, in other words. I'll always have a topic that will, you know, be, like, one whole video. So it could almost, you could, like, you know, it's like an episode, and that's what I'm going to talk about in the episode. God, I'm, like, drawing a lot of things here. This is, like, Rudis, this is going to be, like, a work in progress, because I'm not 100% certain how well this will go over in the first place. I'm also not 100% certain in my ability to actually just do it correctly. I say that because, you know, like, talking about politics is kind of the thing I don't want to constantly interrupt myself in, and that's definitely what I'm going to be doing. Oh, Jesus. Totally let him get away from me. That just, okay. Well, I didn't mean to energy strike that salamander, but I did accidentally, so that's cool. This sucks, by the way. Just want to point that out. Came a little bit closer, guys. Yeah. Ugh. Get him? Oh, I didn't mean to take a step. Crap. There we go. Level up. Yeah, so anyway, I mean, that's just how this is going to work. Wow, so many gold sellers are messaging me. That's cool. In that way, that's definitely not. So anyway, tonight's topic... Oh, by the way, so yeah, like I was just saying, I just want to finish that real quick. This is going to be like a work in progress. I'm not 100% certain, you know, how well this will go. I don't have a, like, you know, predefined plan on how things are going to do. Unlike, obviously, all of my other videos where I kind of just ramble about whatever strikes my fancy, I'm going to have, like, a topic going into this. And it's, like, a real-life topic, something that I can actually, like, research and whatnot, which I will do. So, you know, like, I'm going to do the best to make sure I'm not just spewing crap left and right. But what that means is I occasionally will probably have to pause the videos and, like, look up factoids and things like that. I'm probably going to have some kind of, like notes of what I want to talk about before I get into the video. Anyway, though, with all that said, I do want to get into the actual topic of this one, which is the Democratic debate that happened last night, a couple of hours ago. I chose that for my first one. I was actually going to do something else, but that happened last night, and I figured that was a good topic to talk about. So yeah, generally speaking, I did watch the debate. It ran from my time, by the way. I don't know where everybody else is. It ran from my time. It was supposed to start at 8:30. It started about, I think, 8:50, and it ran from about 8:50 to 10 something. Maybe 11. Five people in it. Hillary Clinton, the obvious front runner of everything. Former senator, former first lady, former secretary of state. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I think everybody knows who Hillary Clinton is. She was the front runner. Bernie Sanders, senator from Vermont, independent. Basically, he's like, he calls himself a democratic socialist, I think he called himself. Lincoln Chafee, I think his name was. You know, I remembered everybody's last names, okay? But not their firsts. So I'm actually going to... It was Chafee, who I now see, like... This is what I'm talking about when I'm going to have to, like, pause and look crap up, right? I do actually already have him on Google, though, so I don't fully need to do that. I hate that I can't swap stuff there. Alright. Let's see, he was a governor of Rhode Island, U.S. Senator, and a mayor. There you go. Not in that order, by the way. He started off as a mayor, then became a senator, then became a governor. I believe he's the one... I don't know. So there was him, there was, let's see, Jim Webb, and also Martin O'Malley. Martin O'Malley apparently did pretty okay. The three that aren't Sanders and aren't, Hillary Clinton are basically, like, non-entities, as mean as that is. There's, like, no way they were gonna, you know, get the nomination, you know, but, I mean, like, it's worth talking about them, and it does a disservice to not talk about them, you know, after they did, like, you know, try. So... Martin O'Malley did an okay job. I thought he had a unfortunate. A TV debate is as much a publicity contest as anything else is. Just as an example, Nixon once debated Kennedy. Nixon, I believe at the time, was like coming off the flu, and you know what Nixon looks like. he has just like a terrible 5 o'clock shadow and everything. Whereas Kennedy's like youthful looking and like, I don't know, handsome and attractive. So the people who watched the debate on TV were all like, oh my god, Kennedy trounced him. Because Kennedy was like confident looking, you know, and like energetic, whereas Nixon was like, airway. So everybody's like, oh yeah, Kennedy won that debate. On the other hand, people who listened to the debate on the radio said that Nixon's answers were more like articulate and, you know, informed, whereas Kennedy was saying a lot of stuff without substance. So, I mean, like, it is worth mentioning that a candidate who looks stupid has a problem. I'm not saying that O'Malley looked stupid, but he sounded almost like tired the whole time. I think he made a poor impression because of that. Lincoln Chafee, I don't know, Chafe? Like, honestly, I know how to pronounce his name, but I can't remember it right now. He actually came off as an okay president to me, at least at the beginning. He kind of had the look of, like, a president. The only problem is that he kind of came off as a president that I think would be okay in, I don't want to say in peace times, because that's not exactly what I mean, but in times when things are running smooth. Like maybe in 2006, for instance. You know, we'd already been bogged down in Afghanistan and Iraq forever. He seems like he would have been okay at that early point. But like, you know, I don't know. Not later than that. Likewise, like, he doesn't seem to be a good president when things are, like, running harshly, in other words. I think he killed, he, like, committed suicide on stage. They were questioning on the, they talked about so many things. They were questioning him about the vote on the repeal of the Glass-Steagall Act, which was something that all of the, you know, the candidates were talking about how they, you know, blah, 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 wouldn't vote for. Yeah. So when he was one of the ones that voted for the repeal. And when asked, like, why did he do that? He was like, because my dad had just died and I had just become a senator and didn't know what I was doing, basically. Which was his defense. Now, to be fair, okay, so, like, I guess his father was the senator before him, and his father had died, and then they, like, voted him in as a special, like, you know, a temporary thing. The governor of whatever the state they were in were just like, okay, you take over for your pops until the election. So, like, okay, to be fair, like, he didn't, that's an annoying time to level up right after I use that potion. So, like, to be fair, he probably, you know, didn't really know what he was doing at that point. And was just voting on the things that were, like, in the works. And, like, to be fair, that is exactly what he said. He was like, you know, I took over for my dad. He's like, you know, I took over for my dad. I just voted on, you know, like, what the staff said we were voting on. I didn't have time to look over all these things. which, like, is kind of fair. I mean, like, he didn't. you know, he kept the staff, he kept the policy and, like, you know, the direction of the former senator who he took over for, which, you know, also happened to be his dad. He doesn't want to, like, immediately, you know, be like, nah, I entirely disagree with my pops. So, like, you know, I give him a little bit of, like, I think that's a fair assessment that he had to go with. But it did totally make him look incompetent. And, I feel like the average voter doesn't understand that's how, like, that process worked, and they just heard that, like, he recently became a senator and then voted for something without knowing what it was. Which makes him look all sorts of incompetent. Regrettably. But yeah, definitely makes him look incompetent. So I think he kind of committed suicide there. That was, like, any chance he had just went down the hill. The other guy, Jim Webb, came off as, like, bickering and kind of petty. He kept, like, arguing with he wasn't getting enough questions sent his way. So he kept, the moderator was Anderson Cooper from CNN. So he kept arguing with Cooper about being like, you know, everybody else is getting more time to talk. I would like more time to talk. He'd like butt into other people and be like, I would like to talk. Whenever he got to talk, he'd run over on his time and be like, well, everybody else got to talk longer. Which, like, you know, I don't know. I'd be a little ticked off too if everybody else was getting more time to talk than I was. But on the other hand, like, everybody knows that's how debates work. Like, he knew what he was getting into. He knew that they were gonna, you know, take as much time as they could, and it's his job to also take that much time. It's his job to be like, well, I'm gonna pull the microphone towards me. I'm gonna become the talker. I'm gonna say something that others have to respond to. I'm gonna interject. I'm going to, you know. Part of the problem was, though, like, the way the debate was set up is that if you, like, reference Bernie Sanders and, you know, said, like, well, I'm better than Bernie Sanders because of this, Bernie Sanders got a chance to respond to you. Because these other guys were, like, non-entities, nobody, it was, like, all Hillary and all Bernie Sanders where people were like, well, Bernie Sanders does this, Clinton does this. Nobody was like, Webb does this, giving him an opportunity to, like, respond. Which is a shame for him. You know, I just thought I would like to point out that I have never looted a shovel in all of my times here. Just want to point that out. Never, ever looted a shovel. Now, how many shovels do I have? Exactly. Dude, seriously, did I just throw a torch down that weighed that much? Oh, whatever, I don't even care. So I don't know, like, to be fair to that guy, it was kind of a rough situation, but still. His job to take care of that, and he wasn't taking care of it. Let's go to the Hungry Dead. Brittle Skeletons. So, I mean, like, he kind of doesn't have anybody to blame for himself. The other thing was, at the end, there was a question, like, it was one of the last questions, and it was, I think it was actually the last question, and it was, you know, and all your years, you've probably made a lot of enemies. Which enemy is the one you're the most proud of? So the one guy, it was either O'Malley or Chafee, I don't remember which one, said, the coal lobby. I cannot remember what Bernie Sanders said. The other one of those two people from the beginning where I said it was either one or the other said the NRA. Hillary obviously had the best answer. Bernie's answer was not good since I don't remember. Hillary had the best answer, and she said, she like ran through a list. She was like, oh, you know, the financial people, she's like, oh, I don't know, there's so many of them, like the financial people, the pharmaceutical companies, the Iranians, because, you know, she pushed on her, like, foreign policy experience. And she was like, but probably I just have to go with, you know, the Republicans. Which I thought was a funny answer. So she definitely won that one. And like I said, Sanders, I don't remember Sanders' response, which probably means it wasn't very memorable. And then Webb said the enemy, I think he served in Vietnam, so he said, like, the Vietnam soldier that threw a grenade at him and injured his leg, but that guy's not around anymore. Implying that, I guess, he killed him, I guess? Like, I don't actually know what his, like, story is, so I don't know, like, the guy threw a grenade at him and then he killed that dude, but I feel like that was kind of while, like, awesome under normal circumstances, I feel like that was a slightly inappropriate presidential response. Like, oh, yeah, that guy that hurt me and I totally killed in response. When I don't like people, I murder them. Again, not that I'm saying, like, killing your enemy in war is murder. Like, definitely not the situation. But still, like, I feel like that was a little bit of an inappropriate response for a presidential candidate. Also, like, I mean, it didn't touch on anything that he was talking about. Like, all the other candidates used that, like, opportunity to, like, push their, you know, Hillary was like, oh, yeah, you know, I stick it to the Republicans all the time. I stick it to the Iranians. you know, the other guy was like, I have a great track record of fighting the NRA, you know. That dude was just like, oh yeah, man, I just totally hate Vietnamese soldiers that I killed. Which I thought was hilarious. But, like, yeah, whatever. So, yeah, anyway, so that was, like, my overall impression of those three guys. So, basically, they're non-entities, and I'm only going to talk about them as far as it refers to the other people who weren't non-entities. So, on that end, Hillary Clinton definitely won the debate. She came off as very, like, impersonable, friendly, knowing her stuff. She came off actually, like, funny. She made a couple of jokes and stuff like that. Bernie Sanders did fine. Bernie Sanders' problem, though, is that he's, as he called himself, again, like a social democrat. Sorry, a democratic socialist. Other way around. And he basically, like, that's a weakness of his. While he's playing it up as a strength, it's definitely just, like, a thing that he needs to get over with. Because, like, I don't think a socialist is actually, you know, electable in the United States. He's gotta expand his appeal to, like, regular people. And he did not do that. So, I mean, he said the things that energize his base, for sure. And he said the things that, like, I'm sure his people wanted him to say. But he did not, like, expand beyond the people that were already excited about him. And that's probably a problem. Because, yeah, like, he's very, very far to the left, which is fine. But for him to have any hope of, like, actually getting elected, he needs to, you know, appeal to some people who aren't going to vote for him currently and are instead voting for Hillary. And he did not do that. So, I mean, he did come off intelligent. He did come off, like, you know, knowing his stuff. He did come off as, like, passionate and, you know, informed and all that stuff. But he didn't come off as anything other than, like, you know, a revolutionary. And anybody who's not clamoring for a revolution already isn't going to start because of what he said. That said, you know, he does warrant, talking about. Like I said, he did seem, like, articulate and intelligent and everything like that. I feel like American socialism isn't gonna fly. He mentioned Denmark and Sweden and, like, a lot of Scandinavian countries as, like, a model for things. And said, you know, like, blah, 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 they do it, so we should do it, too, because it works for them. I'm not so sure if I agree with that sentiment. For starters, I think there's just, like, an issue of practicality. Like, you know, as they mentioned, like, Denmark has a population of, like, 5 million or something like that. To be honest, I don't know what the actual population is of Denmark. But, like, it was mentioned that Denmark's population, like, pales in comparison to the United States population, which, you know, is a valid point. Like, it's a lot easier to give universal health care to everybody in your country when the population of your country is a fraction. I think, actually, to be honest, I'm not even sure that's true. God, I got him. Because, I mean, presumably America's, like, economy and, like, you know, gross domestic product and all that stuff is as many times higher than Denmark's as our population is, at the very least. I would like to hope. I could check that, but it doesn't really matter. But yeah, I mean, so, like, you mentioned that. The thing I was thinking, though, is that, like, the average American probably doesn't even know where Denmark is. Like, I feel like if I gave you a map to the average American and I was like, point out Denmark, the average American could not do that. And, like, is partially, like, the average American being kind of, like, stupid. But to be fair, like, take a look at a map of, like, the North America, right? We've got Canada to our north. Canada, for all intents and purposes, is, like, America too. Alright, we have, like, massive integration with the two militaries. Like, the defense of all of North America, besides Mexico, I suppose, is controlled via NORAD. Canada, for the most part, like, has the exact same, like political views and like as us, I mean, like Canada, for all intents and purposes, could be made the 51st state or something like that, and it would not alter the landscape in any kind of meaningful way. So, like, I feel like it's not, you know, Canada's almost not a foreign nation. Whereas, like, you know, France and Germany are right next to each other, and those are wildly different nations with, like, wildly different perspectives and wildly different cultures. Canada, yes, has its own unique culture, with, like, a touch of French mixed in, but, like, I don't know. It just... Canada is just so similar to the United States, and also, like, effectively a non-entity. Like, it's really big, but it's also, like, cold and stuff like that. Like, so most Americans don't really consider Canada as a thing that needs to be considered, which is, like, not fair to the Canadians for sure, but I mean, like, whatever. Let's drink a potion before I die. And then to our south is Mexico, and, like, Mexico is also effectively an American state, but one that sucks, and it sends over a whole bunch of, you know, problems. And, like, you know, as the Republican debates and, you know, the things the Republicans are saying, nobody really cares about what Mexico has to say either. And, again, that's, like, sort of wrong, but still, like, that's the kind of situation we have right now. Like, nobody really cares about Mexico. So, like, as we Americans, we don't really have to deal with, like, other nations that are important. Like, just because of our size, our economy, and our, like, relative power, Mexico and Canada are just, like, they pale in comparison to us. Whereas, you know, going back to the Germany and France, like, example I just gave, those two countries are, like, you know, equivalent to each other, and... like, are both equally powerful. So, like, if France suddenly starts just hating Germany with a passion, that's actually, like, a thing that Germany has to take care of. Germany can't just ignore that. Good. Hey, I'm done. Whereas, like, if Canada just suddenly starts hating America, I mean, like, what? We don't care. So, I feel like for European nations, okay, I'm going to just kill those things and then be on my way. For European countries that have, like, you know, close borders and are roughly equivalent in power and things like that, there's a little bit more incentive to kind of be, like, knowing what other countries do. Whereas, you know, America just has these two neighbors, and then... huge oceans on both sides, which give us, like, a massive, like, defensive bonus and whatnot. But, I mean, like, you know, the point is that we don't have to care about other countries' perspectives. So, like, you know, just because something works in Denmark, I mean, most Americans don't know where Denmark is. Most Americans don't know where half the countries in Europe are. I mean, like, they probably know France. They probably know, like, the United Kingdom. There's a good chance they don't know Germany, though, because Germany's in the middle of Europe, and that part of the map is confusing. Again, like, this is all stuff that I'm not, like, you know, condoning, but, I mean, it's, like, a legitimate situation there. Do I have to say to this person? Yeah, I have to talk to this person. Hi. What do I do? Decide? Did? Do I just say decided? Yes. Sorcerer. Yes. I'm a sorcerer nowadays. Nah, I don't go through that one. So anyway, my point I'm trying to make here is that by, like, focusing on what European country ABC does is, I think, like, the wrong approach. Because it just, you know... It is just the wrong approach. Like... most Americans don't care about European country ABC. And, I, like, you know, that's kind of wrong, but, I mean, it's the way we're set up with our borders, essentially. Alright. Oh, I wanted to throw the sword for somebody. That's too bad. Oh, well. No free sword for you guys. Where will I be going? Let's go to Thace, I suppose. Alright, hi. Thace. Oh, yes. God, I hate these NPCs. Yes. Yes. No, we're not going to Venor. Cities. We're going to Thace. Sail. Good. I hate this freaking NPC. Thace. Oh, I spelled Thace wrong. That's awesome. Thace. I really hate the NPCs here. Thank you. So yeah, I don't know. Since I didn't finish what I'm talking about, I'm just gonna kind of continue my little, like, stuff here. So yeah, I feel like, you know, drawing references to European countries or Asian countries or things like that is just gonna fall flat on the American voter, because the average American voter just does not know anything about those topics. Again, like I said, that's wrong, but it's also the way it is. I'm definitely gonna pick that up. Because it's probably worth something. Did I not? Oh, they took my shield away? Are you kidding me? You guys took my shield? Up yours. I'm gonna put that away too, because I want the cap. Alright, we're gonna go just kill some, like, wolves or something for food. Also, let's see if somebody tries to PK me at some point. That would be kind of hilarious. Anyway, yeah, I mean, just like, so I feel like that's just going to fall flat on the average American, which is unfortunate, but it's just the way it is. Furthermore, I'm not 100% certain, like, mimicking a European country is correct in the first place. Because, like, here's sort of my thought process, right? Okay? The European countries that they're talking about mimicking, you know, the Scandinavian ones, do have this, like, socialism system set up. By the way, I'm not, like, inherently opposed to socialism or anything like that. But what else can be said about the Scandinavian countries? Well, they're kind of not leading the world militarily or economically. On the other hand, we have America, which is kind of unique in its, like, in its economic system, you know, strong capitalism, not paid leave for people and things like that, not, like, mandatory maternity leave and things like that. And what's America got going for it? Well, America totally is, like, the dominant thing in the world. So, I mean, it could be said that, you know, that, like, harshness, like, you know, tempers the blade, so to say. Or something along those lines. I don't really know if I believe that, but I mean, you know, it's a thought. Like, they're kind of, like, Bernie Sanders is kind of, to me, he's, like, picking and choosing one aspect of the Scandinavian countries that he likes, and ignoring the fact that there's a whole bunch of other traits of the Scandinavian countries that aren't America, and that you might not be able to just pick and choose the good parts without taking some of the other parts, or taking some of the weaknesses of those good parts. That, however, is a topic way above my pay grade. So I'm not going to discuss that any further. Anyway, like I said, though, the big winner was Hillary Clinton. For sure. She, you know, came off just really impressionable. She handled her, like, you know, people kind of talk about Benghazi and stuff like that. She handled all that really well. The one thing was her email servers. For those who don't know, when she was Secretary of the State, she used a private email server, which was, like, technically maybe sort of kind of against some kind of rule. Maybe, who knows? And I say maybe, who knows, because, you know, apparently you're allowed to use a private email server, but you have to have, like, special clearances and blah, 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 because those rules were written before private email servers were things that anybody had to consider. So now they're using a whole bunch of archaic rules to try to figure out if what she did is technically against the rules, and, you know, it's just stupid crap like that. The Republicans hate the fact, though, and, you know, they're leading the charge to get her, I don't know, hung, probably. One of the leading Republicans in the House basically said that, yeah, we're just running this thing because we want to ruin her numbers. He didn't actually say that, but he specifically mentioned that, like, he specifically said Hillary Clinton looked unbeatable, and then we've been running this, like, inquiry into her, and her polling numbers have fallen, so ha ha ha, go us, is basically what he said. So I don't know if he's saying that as a, like, hey, this is an unintended side effect, which is awesome, or if he's saying that, like, yeah, we're screwing her, and that was the goal from the beginning. That's kind of how the Democrats are taking it. I don't really know, or care. But yeah, I mean, okay. So we've got that. So, you know, her email server, though, is a thing that's kind of contentious, and some people are actually a little bit concerned about. And Bernie Sanders actually handed her the, like, the best thing on that ever. Because when he was asked about it, he was like, you know what? I'm sick and tired of hearing about her damn email server. And you know what? He's right. Like, worst case scenario, I mean, like, what does the email server actually show that Hillary did? Like, she preferred her own system that was she was more familiar with? Like, that's not a huge problem. I mean, like, maybe she was reckless by using her own private email server. Maybe she didn't properly secure it. Maybe she knew that she wasn't supposed to use her private email server, and in a bout of extreme hubris, she said, well, I'm going to do it anyway. But, I mean, like, ultimately, what does that say? Like, that kind of says nothing. It's not like, you know, like Richard Nixon, who was, you know, bugging his opponents' offices and things like that. It's not like, you know, Donald Rumsfeld and, like, you know, Dick Cheney selectively hearing certain intelligence so that they could lead us into a war in Iraq with disastrous consequences and loss of life and loss of money. I mean, like, really? What's the huge consequence to Hillary Clinton using her private email server? I mean, maybe it was, like, hacked and, like, stuff was leaked out of it or something like that, but actual corporate emails get hacked by the Chinese and the Russians, like, every day, and actual, like, government servers get hacked and broken into by the Chinese and the Russians every day. So, I mean, like, the stuff was just as insecure on her email server as it was on government servers. Like, I know, I mean, that's not really good, but, I mean, I think that's kind of the case. So, I mean, like, you know, I think Bernie Sanders was right. Like, her email servers are a huge non-entity, and then they're just being brought up to, like, you know, cause a controversy for her. And, I mean, so, yeah, I mean, I think it's, like, pointless. But, yeah, Bernie Sanders basically handed her a win on that. Because, like, after he said that, I mean, nobody else on that stage could, like, hit her on that without looking incredibly petty and pointless. So, yeah, that was that. Hillary basically clearly dominated. Bernie Sanders did okay, but he didn't really expand his appeal beyond his party, beyond his, like, ultra-liberal progressive base. Hillary came off as, like, you know, confident, knowing what she's doing, giving good responses, personable, just, like, great all around. I mean, Hillary just did an amazing job. Like, I'm not going to say that makes her a good president or anything like that, but she just did an amazing job. Like, for sure, Hillary did an amazing job. And the other three were basically not entities. Yeah, I mean, that's basically it. So yeah, that was, like, my analysis of the debate. Nothing of, like, substance was really said. Oh, the one thing I will say, though, and I kind of appreciated this, is that during the debate, they mostly talked, like, policy and differences between their own policies. You know, like, Hillary was like, well, I did this. Bernie Sanders was like, well, I did this, and I think it's better than what this guy is suggesting. They were very civil, though. And all five of them knew that their actual enemy was the Republican eventual. And they said that many times. They were like, we have to fight the Republicans. You know, even Hillary, the enemy she's proudest of, the Republicans. Whereas, you know, the Republicans have just been smashing each other left and right in this, like, brutal primary. Which, just for the record, they did against Obama, I think, both times. And both times, they wasted so much money, and they got so much bad blood, and they threw so much negativity at each other that they weakened themselves when it got to the actual main election. And they're doing the exact same thing. I mean, just look at the difference. There was five Democratic contenders. Vice President Joe Biden still hasn't said whether or not he's going to run, but the fact that he wasn't in the first debate, and the fact that Hillary performed well, basically just kind of massively hurt his chances. On the other hand, there was 17 Republican contenders. And I know a couple of them have dropped out, but still, it's, like, brutal. And they're all, like, racing to top each other with by saying the most, like, outrageous things. And it's they're just going to get hammered with that when the actual election starts. But what I'm trying to say is that the Democrats were very, like, civil, and they were, while they were debating each other, they were all like, hey, we're friends, you know? Like, Bernie Sanders said that, like, I'm tired of hearing about your damn email server, and they both, like, shook hands at that point and, like, laughed while everybody clapped. So, like, they were actually talking policy, and, you know, like, I could see any one of them getting elected and then taking one of the other ones as a vice president, as a, you know, a secretary of state or some kind of position. In fact, like, I think Hillary's probably going to be the one that gets the nomination. I think she's probably going to get elected. And I could see her taking Bernie Sanders as her vice president, and I would actually think that would be a great idea, because they came off incredibly friendly with each other. And Clinton is a little bit more, I think, in a moderate position, and Bernie Sanders is in a little bit more of an ultra-progressive situation. And I think if she took the, like, the women's voters and the moderate position, and Bernie Sanders took the young people, because they tend to be, like, the more progressive ones, and they formed one ticket, I think they would get an amazing turnout. But anyway, so my point is that, like, even with the other three people, who, again, I can't think are non-entities, like, if Lincoln Chafee or O'Malley gets the thing, they could take any one of the others as their vice president or something like that, and I think it would work really well. Whereas if Donald Trump gets the thing, he's definitely not taking Ben Carson as his vice president. If Ben Carson gets the nomination, he's definitely not taking the woman, what's her name, Fiora? He's not taking her. If Jeb Bush gets it, he's not taking Trump. So, I mean, like, it just seemed a lot more civil and, you know, like, polite. All right, folks, so that was my analysis of the Democratic National Debate. I will continue to put these FDR videos up every now and then. Whenever I feel like it, unlike Leaf, FDR will do stuff like, you know, buy spells and things when the video isn't being recorded. It's not a total playthrough. And on that note, folks, I will walk myself over to the temple. But you guys should like, favorite, comment, subscribe, check me out on Patreon, Twitter, and Facebook. I'd also like to say, and I should have said this at the beginning of the video, I wholly welcome, any kind of comments on my political views in addition to the content of the video. If you want to comment on where I should hunt in free lands, please feel free to do so. If you also want to comment on something you think I should talk about, or you just want to disagree or agree with whatever I just said, please do so. I will do my best to respond to people in the comments, like I do for all of my videos. If, however, you say something that's actually, like, you know, large, I could potentially make a video in response to it. And I will respond if you're disagreeing with me. I do, however, ask that you disagree with me in a, like, intelligent, not frothing at the mouth screaming manner. I don't think you can really disagree too much with me on what I just talked about, because this was mostly just my analysis of things. You could definitely be like, well, I don't think, you know, whatever. But, like, when we talk about, like, let's say, like, gun control or something like that, you could definitely have an opinion that differs than mine on gun control, for sure. If you disagree with my opinion, I would prefer you to say something along the lines, if I disagree with your opinion because of A, B, C, D, and not, oh, you're an idiot, die in a hole, I hope you get shot. You know what I'm saying?
That enters stone.
So, yeah. All right, folks, I will let you guys go.